drugs, no heavy losing. I was willing to do all of this anyway. Anyway, without Hitler's prodding. By January of 1996, rumors of our reunion began to surface. Gene was doing a radio interview in Chicago when the announcer asked him if his reunion was possible. Fairy tales can come true. It can happen to you, Gene quickly said. We made our first public appearance in makeup at the Grammy Awards on February 28. We were backstage in full makeup and costume, and most of the stars thought that we were a discover band about to perform. In actuality, we were going to present the Grammy with Tupac Shakur, the rap artist. Right before we went on, we convened in a little room and Gene and Paul started lecturing me condescendingly on how to speak to Tupac. Peter, you know that Tupac Shakur is a real gangster. He's been shot a number of times and he's the real deal, so don't rub him the wrong way. Don't call him names. Of course, there was no drama. Tupac was wearing an expensive Versace suit and was a perfect gentleman. Let's shock the people, he said, and we ambled out onto the stage. The audience went berserk and gave us a standing ovation, led by Eddie Vedder. Backstage afterward, all the stars had finally realized that we were the real Kiss, and they all applauded us. We were on our way. Now the hard work began. Got a personal trainer. Mine was named Gregory and he was a weirdo. He had been Paul's trainer and he belonged to the Hare Krishna cult, so he had a shaved head. He took me to his temple one night and we did some chanting together. Gregory just kicked my ass. And he had me drinking power drinks, distilled water, cleaning out my whole system. I'd meet him at Gold's Gym in Venice at 9 in the morning and we'd train for 2 hours straight. We did the treadmill for a half hour and then stretched and lifted weights. He taught me yoga positions. He was literally chiseling my body. I lost more than 25 pounds. I was in the best shape of my life. After the gym session, I'd drive to my drum tutor and drum for an hour. I had to relearn all the old Kiss songs. It was humiliating to go meet some punk drummer and copy him playing my old shit because I had forgotten how to do it. At night I would watch VHS after VHS of his concerts. My tech and I would study them like football coaches. I had to relearn my body movements, the way I moved my head, the way I spun my steps. I hated myself because some of that early drumming was pretty intricate. After working with the drum tutor, I'd spend an hour Tommy Thayer, just guitar and drums. He was Gene and Paul's conduit for everything, but he was a Kiss historian who knew the most meta details of every show we ever did. We played Deuce and Strutter and Detroit Rock City, and it wasn't easy to relearn all these songs I hadn't played for almost 20 years. Then I'd go downtown and rehearse with the band. They rented some cheap, cramped little studio. That's the way they wanted it, so no one could fuck up and make a mistake and get away with it. Gene and Paul were right on top of my drums, so I was lucky to be able to breathe. We worked like dogs in that place. But I didn't mind working hard. I was 50 years old, older than the other guys, but I just thought of it as training for Tyson. You better be in great shape to get in the ring with him. Gene and Paul were workaholics to begin with, so they worked their asses off. But Ace was Ace, he was always lazy. He didn't take too kindly to all this regimentation. When we thought we had gotten better, we went into a larger rehearsal space, sir. We set up on a stage with a sound system and we lined my drums. Gene and Paul would get there early, just to try to catch us if we were late. I was always on time, but Ace never was, and Gene would sit there and look at his watch. I'd get upset with Ace, too, because I was ready to go. So Gene sent the facts to the effect of if you don't get your ship in a van. Every now and then we'd stop at a light and people would see us, go crazy, and charge the van. When we got to the ship, there were hundreds and hundreds of press people there. Doc had the room completely darkened, and then a huge kiss sign lit up and we each walked out with a spotlight on us. It was like the scene from Close Encounters when the aliens walked into the light. The cameras flipped away like crazy. After we posed, we sat down at a table and the questions came from reporters from all over the world. I was so proud to be part of something that was the biggest story on the planet at the time. The tour dates were announced, and tickets went on sale shortly after that. I was back in El Dorado. Asleep at 6 in the morning one day, when the phone rang. Rocky, I picked it up. Peter, are you sitting, standing, or lying down? Gene said in his monotone. I'm fucking sleeping, I said. The sun is just coming up. We just sold out Tiger Stadium in 7 minutes. 40,000 seats. No enthusiasm. No excitement. Motion. He was just Joe the robot. But I jumped out of bed, screaming. And that was the way it went for venue after venue. 2 straight years of touring, all around the world, sold out. Once the tour had been announced, I got paranoid that the IRS was going to garnish my wages. By then my tax bill had mounted to $3 million and I had finally hired Carol White, the tax specialist, help me. She had me file for bankruptcy, which Ace also did. That was a heavy day for me. Going from millions and millions to filing Chapter 13. By then both Gene and Paul had paid $1 million each to the IRS. Gene told me that he was sick and throwing up every day for a year after he signed over that $1 million check to them. Carol worked it out so that after a certain number of days of my bankruptcy filing, my IRS debt would get wiped out and everything I made after that was mine. My biggest fear was the IRS would get wind of the KISS tour and then I'd be working for them. Those days went by so slow. Every day I dreaded getting that letter in the mail from the IRS. But despite all the publicity,